Subscribe to LearnCab and hit the bell icon to get notified.
Dear learner, let us get started with a fresh set of chapters, and we're going to discuss about security valuation. Now, let us try to understand what are the areas that we need to cover in this particular chapter. Now, let's discuss the learning outcome of security valuation chapter. Initially, we need to discuss what is the concept of value and what is the concept of valuation. Where would we would use this particular valuation concept? Then we would go ahead and have an overall understanding and then detailed understanding with questions on valuing following type of securities. What are the securities that we are going to value? It includes your equity shares. It even includes your preference shares and even includes your debentures and bonds. So first, initially, we would discuss about equity, then preference, then we would go to intrinsic concepts of debentures or bond valuation. Then we have a theory that is to be discussed called as arbitrage pricing theory. So this is the overall understanding of this chapter. Now you're excited. So let's get ahead with our chapter and try to understand the initial concept. Are you all ready? Okay, good. So what is the concept of valuation? Now per se, let me ask you this question. What do you mean by value of an asset? Okay, in the initial chapters that I had discussed about how to analyze a particular security and all that, now we are taking back to the basics and just recapping what is the basis of a value. Now, why we need to have valuation would actually give the answer for what is value of an asset. Why we need to have valuation? Because as an investor or as a person who is going to buy that particular asset, what is that objective that we would have? Always, we need to go and purchase that asset which is actually lower priced in the market. So there must be something called as an actual value somebody is ready to pay for a particular asset. What do you mean by actual value? So what is that as an investor you would be ready to pay for a particular asset? It is nothing but present value of the future returns that particular asset is going to give you. So this is the fundamental of all valuation. Value or the real value is nothing but present value of future returns of a particular asset. Now what could be an asset? Asset could be anything. It could be a physical asset or it could even be a financial asset. A physical asset could include a house, a car, or a financial asset could be a share, a security, a particular bond, mutual fund, whatever it is. So all these assets, the basic concept remains the same. What is the basic concept? Whatever you are going to pay for a particular asset would be the present value of its future returns. Now, when it comes to a physical asset, let's think of it. As an investor, I'm not going to use this particular asset, but as an investor, I want to invest in a property. And I would check how much is that the property is going to give me in the future. If at all there is an option to give it on rent, rent is something that I'm going to get in the future. And is that all? No, I'm going to sell this asset off after some particular period of time. And when I'm selling this particular asset, I'm going to get a redemption value. That's the name that I'm giving for that. When I'm selling this asset, I'm going to get something and I'm going to get periodic returns as a rental. So I have to calculate what would be the today's value for these future returns I'm going to get. And that is what I'm ready to pay, or that is the actual value of an asset. Now, how to derive value? There are two types of values that you need to learn. One is intrinsic value, which we learned in the earlier chapters. And we have something called as market price. What's the difference between intrinsic value and market price? We need to understand. Now, what is an intrinsic value? Let's read this. How much is the true worth of an asset is called as intrinsic value. Like I've been talking about real value of an asset. How much is that? The actual value an asset could derive from the market is called as intrinsic value. But because of various reasons, it is not necessary that every asset would be valued at its correct value in the market. So market price could be different. So what a person is ready to pay for that particular asset is called as market price. So what you're going to pay is called as market price, and what you really get is called as intrinsic value or real worth of an asset. So both of this can be derived differently. So sometimes, or in the longer run, our assumption is that the asset that is going to have a market price today would ideally move to get to its intrinsic value in the future. Okay, this is the overall idea that I will be telling you in the frequent discussions we are going to have. Now let's take an example and try to understand this. I told you there could be two type of values, intrinsic value and then market price. Now let's try to calculate how do you derive at the present value of your future returns. Like I told you, how much you're ready to pay today depends on how much you're going to get in the future. So what are the things that you're going to get? Let's summarize it. I told you, you will get periodic returns. For when it comes to a house, I told you there are rental incomes that you're going to get, which we are going to call it as periodical returns. And we are going to get a redemption value while we are selling that particular asset as such in the future. So these two things are actually lying in the future. So what is that? The present value of these would be the value of a particular asset. Now let's take some number and try to discuss this. Say you have planned to purchase an asset today which is promising 100 per annum for next 4 years, and end of fourth year you are going to receive a redemption of 1200. Now we are going to derive at what could be the value that you are going to pay for this particular asset today. Okay, let's discuss this. So what is that I told you? You have 4 years, you wanted to calculate value today. So today I am going to earmark it as year zero. So you need value for today. So I told you it depends upon how much value you're going to get in the future. Then I told you in the future you're going to have two type of returns. One is called as periodic returns, and the next one is called as redemption value. So in our example, I told you that in the 4 years to come, you're going to get an yearly income of 100 rupees each. So year 1, year 2, year 3 and year 4, I'm going to get a periodic return of rupees 100 each. And at the end of year 4, you're also going to get 1200 rupees because you're going to sell this particular asset off. So which means your holding period for this particular asset is considered to be 4 years. Now my question to you is this: can I just derive at the value by adding all this? No, we already know that the value that we have in different time horizon cannot be clubbed together, because there's a concept called as time value of money. So I need to derive at present value of all this. What do you mean by present value? Value today. So that would be the value that you are going to pay for that particular asset today. Now how do you derive at the present value is the next question that you have. So anything that is lying in the future, to derive at the present value, I require something called as a discount rate. So next set of understanding should be to pick this particular discount rate and discount all these particular incomes and derive at value today and sum it all. That would be the value of that particular asset today. So this is a generic understanding of this particular calculation. So this would follow for all type of asset. Now let us move to in detail calculation of each of these values. Now I wanted to get into the next set of concept called as return concept. Now in any security valuation, you have two type of returns that frequently come across your discussion. One is called as required rate of return, another one is called as expected rate of return. Now, how I am going to discuss this chapter across is that we are going to number each of the term that we are going to discuss. Also, we will number the formulas that we are going to discuss, so that end of the discussion, we can summarize all of this. So, the term 1 that I am going to teach you today is required rate of return, and term 2 is expected rate of return. Now, let us bring an understanding on these two terms. What is required rate of return? See, as an investor, you are putting money into this particular security. So, when you put money into security, you have a cost associated with this particular money that you have. So, this particular money that you have would come with a cost. So, how much is that minimum return that the security should give for that particular investor is called as a required rate of return, which means it could be the cost of capital of that particular investor. Or we can put it in this way, what is the opportunity cost? That the investor has for this particular security. Because if he is not investing in this particular security, he could have put this particular money in some other security. Now, if at all he has put this particular security, put this particular money in some other security, he would receive an income. So, at least that income is something that we need to compensate for him. So, this is what is called as required rate of return. Now, generally you have this term interchangeably used with another term called as expected rate of return. So, expected rate of return is rather a concept from the investor perspective. So, how much is that investor expects from this particular security? Depending upon that, he would actually prefer to pay that particular security in the market. So, we'll get a little more understanding on this with some examples in the later slides. Before that, let us try to recap. Required rate of return is the concept that is being used for valuation, or it is one of the return concept which says how much that the investor expects out of a particular security that he invests. So, he has an opportunity cost or he has a cost of capital. So, minimum required rate of return for him to put the money into your security is called as required rate of return. Now, let us try to understand what is expected rate of return. So, this is from the investor perspective. So, investor says, my required rate of return could be different from my expected rate of return. So, say he has a required rate of return or cost of capital say 10%, and based on this, this is security valued at 100 rupees. So, this is a security which is giving 10% return at ₹100. But if his expectation on this particular security is, say for example, 15%. So, if his expected rate of return is 15%, will he be ready to pay the same 100 rupees for this particular security? No. So, he will be ready to pay less than 100. What could be the reason? Because if he is getting 10% return on ₹100 that he is paying, his required rate of return only is matched 10%. But how much is that he is expecting? 15%. So, anyway, this particular security is going to give 10 rupees as a return because its value is 100 and it is going to give 10% return. say this 10 rupees return for rupees 100 investment is 10% only. How much he wants? He wants 15%. So he would say that I would pay you much, much lesser so that I get a 15% return even if you are giving me 10 rupees. That is how expected return is being calculated. So which means the market price will be derived based on my expected rate of return. Okay, we will have a little more understanding on this. Okay, so let's put a formula on how to calculate what is the expected rate of return. So formula number one, which says expected rate of return is equal to required rate of return less based on my expectation. What would I do? I would actually be ready to pay less than the actual value or more than the actual value. Say it is giving me, in the earlier discussion, it is giving me 10% or rupees 10 and I want only 8%, then I'll be even ready to pay more than 100 for this particular security. So I would actually change the intrinsic value and the market price based on how much is my expectation. So expected rate of return is required rate of return plus intrinsic value minus price in the market divided by market price. So where ERT is expected rate of return. And RT is required rate of return. And V0 is intrinsic value. And P0 is considered to be the market value. So the first formula that we need to learn is how to calculate expected rate of return. We used to call the difference between expected rate of return and required rate of return to be alpha. And this concept we will discuss later. But the difference is called as alpha. And that is mainly because of the price difference. And what is that I told you would happen in the long term? The price has to go and converge into the intrinsic value. So at that time, expected rate of return would actually realize that particular additional return because of the price difference. So the security is going to give me only this, and I'm going to get this additional return because of the price differences. This is understanding. Okay, so expected rate of return is required rate of return plus intrinsic value minus market price divided by market price. So this would give me another return. So we'll try to calculate a particular question and then we will improve our understanding on this. Okay, now let's read the question. This is an example question for you. Suppose that the current price of a share of ABC Limited is rupees 30 per share. And the investor estimates that the intrinsic value, the actual value of ABC Limited shares to be rupees 35 per share with required return of 8% per annum. Estimate the expected return of ABC Limited. So here the calculation says the current market price is 30 and the intrinsic value of this particular share is 35. Okay, though the intrinsic value, which is in the future, is 35. The currently market is giving me only 30, which means my required rate of return is only 8%. So with required rate of return of 8% and it is giving 35 rupees, it is actually having the value of 35 rupees, but still the investor is ready to pay 30 only, which means he wants more than 8% as return. Now let's try to analyze this question and calculate what is the expected rate of return with our formula. So let's try to understand the value given. So they said required rate of return. How much is required rate of return? Which we call as RT. is only 8%. And intrinsic value, which we call as V0, is rupees 35. But market price is only rupees 30, which means market wants, or the investor wants, more than 8%. That is why for a share actually valued at 35, he is ready to pay only 30. Okay. So how do I calculate what is expected rate of return? So we have our formula. What is our formula? Expected rate of return is equal to required rate of return plus intrinsic value minus price divided by price. So what is my rate of return, required rate of return? It is 8%. What is my intrinsic value? 35, wherein my market price is only 30 divided by 30. So which means 8% plus, I'm getting an additional return of 35 minus 30 is 5 divided by 30. So which means that is 8% plus 16.67%, 5 divided by 30. So which makes it the expected rate of return is 24.67%. So what is your understanding on this? It says expected rate of return is 24.67. So even the current market price is 30 today, in the future it is going to give me a return of 24.67, because that's my expected rate. So which means ideally from 35 it is going to grow only at 8%, but I'm not ready to pay 35 today. I'll be paying only 30 rupees because I don't want 8%. I want 24.67%. That's my expectation. You guys are with me? Okay, good. So let's try to understand this. If that's the case, what is the market price today? It is 30. So what would be the, say we will take a time horizon of 1 year for our example. If that's the case, what will be the market price after an year? It should be 30 plus 30 into 24.67%, which means it should be 30 plus 7.4, which means it should be 37.4. So the price of this particular share should be 37.4, so that the 24.67% expected return is met. You're with me, right? So this is the main understanding between expected rate of return and required rate of return. So our formula is expected rate of return is equal to required rate of return plus intrinsic value minus market price divided by market price. Now let's move to the next concept called as equity risk premium. This is the next concept, term 3. So term 1 was our expected rate of return, 2 was required rate of return, 3 is equity risk premium. Now what is equity risk premium? So this is a detailed concept in a particular theory called as CAPM, which we would discuss, but for the time being we need to know what is equity risk premium in common man language. Equity risk premium is the excess return that investment in equity shares provide over a risk-free rate, such as return from a tax-free government bonds. I'll give you a little more understanding on this. See, say your return would mainly depend upon how much risk you are ready to take. You're aware of this? Yes. So if you are taking zero risk, you would have a return. So in which kind of a security you would take zero risk? It could be a tax-free government bonds. That's where we would say that we have no risk because we are going to get our money back. Okay, and that gives you, say, 5%. Now, I'm asking you, or you're happily investing in this particular security which gives you 5% return without any risk. Now, I'm asking you that, no, from this 5% return, I have an offer for you. I have a particular security which gives you more than 5%, which means if at all zero risk gives you 5%, and I'm going to give you 6% return, which means I'm asking you to take some kind of a risk. Now, how much is the risk that you are additionally taking would require an additional return that should be offered. So each of your additional risk that you're taking above 5%, I need to offer you a return. How much is this additional return that I'm going to offer is called as risk premium. Because you're taking a risk, I'm giving you a premium return. Now let us read it again. So equity risk premium is the excess return that the investment in equity shares provides over a risk-free rate. Now we have to understand how do we calculate this equity risk premium. Like I told you, this comes from a concept called as capital asset pricing model. And in this particular model says, your required rate of return of a security is equal to risk-free rate plus, we have a term called as beta, multiply with what is that the market risk that you have minus risk-free rate. This is the formula for calculating what is Rx, required rate of return. So wherein Rx being the required rate of return of security X, and RF is the risk-free rate, and this is called as beta, and RM being return of market. Okay, now I'll give you a little more understanding. So if I'm taking, like in the earlier example I told you, if the risk-free return is offering you 5%, I need to offer you an additional premium so that you would be ready to move from risk-free to your security called as X. This is the understanding of required rate of return. Are you with me? Now let's move to the next formula. We need to calculate what is risk premium alone. So what would be risk premium? What is equity risk premium? Equity risk premium is nothing but what is the required rate of return minus what is the risk-free rate. Or I can tell you, equity risk premium is equal to beta multiply with return of the market minus risk-free rate. Okay, this would be the formula for equity risk premium. Now let's bring a little more understanding to it. Say, for taking zero risk, somebody is offering you 7%. And now you have to take higher risk. Whether you would be happy with this 7%? No, you will not be happy. So I'll have to give you more than 7. Say I have to give you 8%. So If that's the case, my risk premium is called as 1%. Let's do an example and get a little more understanding to it. Say, this is a calculation based question. So, risk free rate is 5% and beta is 1.5% and equity risk premium is 4.5%. Calculate required rate of return on equity. Now, I need to have a little more understanding on beta for me to discuss this particular question. What do you mean by beta? Beta actually gives you a concept on what is the additional risk that you are taking for a particular security compared to the market. See, there are two type of movements. Somebody who is into risk-free investment, okay, he is investing in government bonds. I'm asking him, you come to security market, come to equity market. So from moving from risk-free to equity market itself, I have to offer him a additional return. Now, from this particular market, will all the stocks have same set of risk? It may not. So each of the stocks might have different set of risk that is available. If that's the case, now we need to discuss how much would be the return, that is how much would be the risk that is particular to a security compared to the market. Say there is a security which is actually the same, which is taking the same risk as the market, which means the beta of that particular security will be same as market, which is called beta 1. If market is running on a risk of 1 and this particular security is double risky, then I need to offer him from the market premium twice. I have to offer him as a return for him to invest in this particular security. So, which means my beta would be 2. You are understanding? Good. Now, let us go ahead and solve this particular question. Risk-free rate is 5%, beta is 1.5%, and equity risk premium is 4.5%. You are required to calculate required rate of return on equity. So, what is required rate of return equity in CAPM model? Return of an equity is equal to risk-free rate plus beta multiply with RM minus RF. So in this particular question, they have given what is risk-free rate. How much is the risk-free rate? It is 5%. And how much is beta? It is 1.5. Then how much is the equity risk premium? So equity risk premium of market is 4.5%, which means market has to offer 4.5%. Now the security has to offer 1.5 times of it. So if that's the case, how do I calculate what would be the, so market risk premium is called as RM minus RF. So, how much is that I have to offer additionally for this particular security is called as required rate of return. So, in our question, required rate of return RX is equal to how much is the risk-free rate? That is 5% plus beta is 1.5 times, risk premium is 4.5%. So, 5% plus 6.75%, 1.5 times of 4.5, so which makes it 11.75% to be the required rate of return. Required rate of return of this particular security, 11.75%. Understanding? Now let's move to discount rate. What is the concept of discount rate? Why do we need discount rate? Because all this discussion that we had about returns, equity risk premium, all this has to go towards security valuation. So I told you basics of valuation is this. I need to have different returns that is coming in the future, and I'll have to take it to today's value. So to take it to today's value, I need discount rate to be applied. So what are the discount rate that can be applied? What do you mean by discount rate? So it's a rate at which present value of future cash flow is being determined. That is the basics of it. And depending upon what you're calculating, whether it's intrinsic value or whether it is market price and all that, your discount rate selection would be different. Okay, you would understand when we are discussing the questions. And discount rate is depending upon the risk-free rate and risk premium of an investment. So if it's required rate that you're taking as discount rate, then risk-free rate and risk premium of an investment comes into picture. And risk over different time horizon is different, hence discount rate also would be different. So which means even in many questions we would see a single discount rate, but ideally discount rate are to be different over different years or different time horizon that we are picking. And discount rate cannot be the same because each year might have different type of discount rate available, because my risk is different. Okay, now let's try to understand this. So risk over different time horizon is different. So I told you that there should be different discount rate that is there, but in practically we might use a single discount rate, and we'll discuss how this is being calculated. Okay, say let's take a practical question, and which is a solved question, and try to discuss. Say I have 5 years and I have 5 cash flows coming in. So your understanding or your objective is to derive at value today. I want to derive at value today, or I wanted to know what would be the present value of these cash flows. So something that I'm getting in the future. So cash inflows that I'm getting in the future, I wanted to know what would be the value today. So year 1 I'm getting 100, year 2 200, year 3 300, 400, 500. That's how. Then I told you that in different time horizon I'll have this different discount rates. Here I'm having 2%, 3%, 4%, 5%, 6%. So since this is different, my present value factors would also be different. So you know how do we calculate present value factor, right? So 1 divided by 1 plus r power t. So which year you are calculating, you will have to discount to that many numbers, number of years. So these are my present value factors, and it should ideally go smaller as the year comes in, because my discounting is on multiple years. So I will get, if I multiply my present value factor with my cash flow, I would get what is my present value of the cash flows. So I have all the 5 years cash flow taken into present value. So year 100 multiply with 0.9804 would give you 98.04. Similarly, 200 multiply with 0.94. Similarly, you calculate all, you will get what is your discounted cash flow. Now, all these discounted cash flow, if I sum. Now, what is the understanding of this discounted cash flow? These are all at year zero's value, because I'm expecting that 98.04 at the year 1 and 98.04 year today and 100 after 1 year is same, because my discount rate or my opportunity cost is 2% over 1 year. Similarly, 188 is today is equal to 200 after 2 years, or at the end of year 2, at 3% discount rate. This is the understanding. Now, present value of discounted cash flow from this calculation is 1255.47. So this is the present value of all these cash flows. So getting 100, 200, 300, 400, 500 over next 5 years and getting 1255.47 today is same, provided my discount rates are this. Now I can actually calculate an equatable rate for the same, saying 100, 200, 300, 400 and 500, if I discount with a common rate, And if I get a present value of 1255.47, I would still have a single discount rate calculated. So if the same cash flows we discount at a rate of 5%, so instead of discounting it at different rates 2 to 6, if I discount all this at 5%, I would still get 1255.47. So all our calculation would be based on that. But that does not mean practically I might have a same discount rate for all the years. I might have different, but we are calculating a single discount rate. Okay, see, if you discount it at 5%, we get approximately 1256. So it's very pretty close. Now you have two type of cash flows that you can consider. One is a real cash flow, another one is a nominal cash flow. Real cash flow is always, whenever we use the term real, it means I do not consider the inflation amount on my future income. If that particular cash flow is having a component of inflation and that is also considered in the cash flow, then I'm calling it as nominal cash flow. So my discount rate would be based on whether I'm using a real cash flow or a nominal cash flow. So in ideal scenarios, real cash flow would give you the actual picture, because if you're getting 100 today and if you're getting 105 tomorrow and you have 5% inflation, then your money in the future is actually 100 only with inflation itself. So you can use two type of cash flows for your calculation, which is real cash flow, which is actually not accounting your inflation, which is keeping the inflation same over the years, and nominal cash flow even considers inflation. So these are the basic concepts I want to tell you before we get into different models of valuation. So let's summarize. So what are the terms that we have learned? We have learned basics of valuation. So basic concept of valuation is what? It is nothing but present value of future returns. Future returns are two types. One is a periodic return and another one is a redemption value. And you have two type of concept, return concept I told you. One is required rate of return, which is the opportunity cost of the investor or cost of capital of the investor, which we actually said could be in CAPM method, risk-free rate plus the equity risk premium. And there is expected rate of return, which the investor expects that the security should give. Based on that, he would actually ready to pay for that particular security. And equity risk premium is the additional risk premium that the investor needs to get because he's taking a higher risk than the risk-free return. Then formulas, we have actually learned three formulas, which is pretty simple. Formula number one is how to calculate expected rate of return from your required rate of return. So expected rate of return is equal to required rate of return plus intrinsic value minus market price divided by market price. Then we have learned the second formula, which says required rate of return of a security is equal to risk-free rate plus beta multiplied with RM minus RF. This is based on our CAPM analysis, capital asset price method. Third one is, what is equity risk premium? Which is nothing but required rate of return minus risk-free rate. Or if it is market risk premium, RM minus RF. If it is equity risk premium for a security, beta of that security multiplied with RM minus RF. These are the formulas that we have to learn. So thank you.